And it's registering. I'll let you know. I'll give you a thumbs up when it hits.
Okay.
They're in front.
They're in front.
Yeah. All
right, you're good to go.
I want to make a point of order that this is my student sitting in front.
Okay. And I'm going to take my phone out. My watch battery. Whatever.
I'll start with some kind of general comments about the current government, public opinion in Israel, drawing from the interview you just saw in terms of where they see kind of democracy versus a Jewish state and other kinds of issues. I'll talk a little bit about where Israel is rated these days in terms of ratings of democracy that different organizations do, also related to Poland and Hungary, and even some categories with the US. I'll talk about some trends in terms of public opinion polls, in terms of possibilities for a new government, and a little bit in foreign policy implications, and we'll each have a little overlap, but also concentrate on other things. So bear with me, because I'll try to cover a lot. If anything any of us says is confusing or you don't understand, and if it's something quick, don't hesitate to put your hand up. But otherwise, we'll wait till we're all done. We might have a little bit of conversation amongst us, and then we'll open it up. And there's so much going on that hopefully we'll have a great discussion after that. So Professor Zaitan's going to talk a little bit about different kinds of democracy as well in his PowerPoint. But something's actually influenced by my dad, who's sitting in the audience, who is also an Israel studies professor, is viewing Israel as a hybrid democracy. So Professor Zaitan will talk more about different categories, but you know, different scholars have different opinions as to where Israel lies in the continuum. And at least the way we see it is that it's a mixture of kind of a liberal democracy element, and you can see that with the interview with Justice Ehud Barak, looking at kind of the protection of civil rights, human rights, minority rights as part of the liberal democracy through various things, including judicial review. Part of it is kind of a ethnic democracy, as categorized, in which it, as Ahavon Barak was saying, prioritizes and privileges the Jewish majority in different ways. And part of it is a associational democracy in which, you know, you have power sharing, as we had witnessed in countries like the Netherlands and in Lebanon and in other countries around the world, where something that's coming to the fore now, which is increased polarization between ultra-Orthodox, Orthodox religious Jews, and others, is part of status quo agreements in terms of power sharing in a associational democracy. So in this sense, you have if right, scholars can disagree as well, may disagree on what it is, or even if it is a democracy before, even under Ahavon Barak, Justice, or before this current government. But if you think that, then you have a jockeying of which of these in the hybrid democracy becomes more prominent. And certainly, since the new government was formed in December 2022, we see the most right-wing religious government that we've ever had in Israel, whose part of their major agenda is to really weaken, if not eliminate for some of them, the liberal democracy parts and really weaken the power of the Supreme Court while increasing the ethnic democracy kind of parts of this and reconfiguring who has power in the consociational part of the democracy. So I think, you know, we don't have time to cover too much, but I think part of the reasons we have this, I would say dangerous government right now, dangerous to Israeli democracy, to rights and to certain security and foreign policy issues as well, is the result of the continued occupation by Israel of the West Bank and stagnation of the peace process for so many years under Netanyahu. I think has fed this. And the religious schools and schools in general, which maybe are not sufficiently teaching pluralism and the importance of democracy. So, I think there's no question, and several Israeli prime ministers said this, that the occupation undermines democratic values and democratic culture. It emboldens settlers. It's continuing to undermine the rule of law. Now it threatens even, or makes legal even settlements that were illegal under Israeli law. The new ministers, National Security Minister Ben-Gvir, especially, and also Smotrich, they really want to completely weaken not only the Supreme Court, but the code of ethics of the Israel Defense Forces and its responsibilities in the West Bank. And the context that has contributed to this is the misperception that the conflict between Israel and the Palestinians can be managed with this bliss of soul. So all these things over so many years certainly, I think, have challenged and weakened and undermined some democratic values, liberal parts of the democracy already, and the rule of law. You also have the populist nationalism and ultra-nationalism. I'm going to get to some statistics in terms of public opinion. We have the social media that sometimes has become less responsible, and social media has become kind of inflammatory reporting, which furthers polarization. You have increased polarization in the society, increased inequalities between different segments of the society. And nevertheless, in this context, what's inspiring is, of course, almost 9 months of hundreds of thousands of Israelis demonstrating often at least twice a week, which would be equivalent to 20 million Americans demonstrating every single week for 9 months. People are exhausted, and they're making sacrifices in terms of their family, in terms of their jobs, and are out there fighting for democracy. And to some degree, it's been very successful, because in many ways, they have succeeded in halting and challenging what the government intended to do with some of the extremists who are in the government. So if you look, one thing that's interesting in terms of providing context to what's going on today is looking at the Israel Democracy Institute, which is a great, if you're ever interested, kind of nonpartisan NGO that really studies and researches different elements of Israeli democracy and public opinion, and how things are deteriorating, what can be done to improve Israeli democracy. And they have for many years given annual reports and surveys on where things stand, or at least where public opinion stands. And so they've seen, the most recent one in 2022 that was concluded, they've seen an erosion in shared principles of civil equality and greater polarization. So right now only 49% of Jewish Israelis agree that Jewish citizens of Israel should have more, that 49% of Jewish Israelis think that Jewish citizens of Israel should have more rights than non-Jewish citizens, something that's really shocking, and that has really grown they grew by 20% just since 2018, right? So in 4 years, this statistic in terms of citizen rights and equality rose, from 27% to 49%. So what all has gone into that, in terms of some of the press, the extremism, the legitimization of these kinds of thoughts. And some of the cleavages in the past few years that, at least in public opinion, were mainly drawn from right and left, have shifted to Jews and Arabs. So when Jewish Israelis have been polled in 2022, 43% prioritized, what you saw in this interview is a Jewish state and democracy, but how do you resolve those tensions? So 43% say they would prioritize the Jewish element, 30% said they would give equal prioritization, and only 20% would say they give priority to the democratic element, right? So there are statistics like that in public opinion, which you see in terms of shifts to the right, in terms of some of this thinking and how people are prioritizing democracy versus the Jewish state. This is especially true among religious Jews. Now, what's also interesting is that currently 62% of Israeli Jews define themselves as being on the right, and the younger they are, the more they define themselves as being on the right. Only 24% define themselves as being in the center, and 11% on the left. So that provides some context, right, to the government today. Now, there's always complications and challenges to this, because some of the right has shifted to the center. Some of the right believes in two-state solution, which they didn't previously. So there's been, some shifts in some of the right, but still you have these trends that are exacerbated by, of course, ultra-Orthodox having more kids. So they, about 13% of the population, for it has to be 16% of the population, if you use it more. And so since they're often in a different school system and so forth, there's concern about what that's going to mean politically, no matter what happens currently. in terms of the politics. What's interesting is a lot of Israelis think that the security has plummeted, and so that provides an association for voting for the right. So it went, saying the state is able to ensure your security was only 38% in 2022, down from 76% in 2020. So a huge drop in security that people feel, very low trust in political parties and so forth. Now, what's interesting is, of course, if you measure democracy by political participation, that has actually increased. And that was even before all the demonstrations of the last 9 months. So Israel gets higher scores in terms of participatory democracy. If you look at those who support the protests, it's still 48% versus 41%. So still a larger percent support the protests that have been going on. Well, very interesting, and probably Professor Zaidan will get to some of this, is even though a lot fewer Arab Israelis are participating in the protests, actually 72% of them support the protests when they're asked. So that's a really interesting statistic. And what's also very interesting is even though we see the shift to the right, where 62% of Israelis identify with the right, 30% of those who identify with the right are out demonstrating every week. So that's really interesting and complicates things a little bit as well, that they themselves don't necessarily want to see this drastic weakening of the democracy. I'm going to skip some things because I hear under-preparing, I over-prepare. But let me see. My husband's laughing because last time it was like adding things. So, I'm going down to a skipping section, going on to another section. So one measure by Freedom House of democracy is the chances for the opposition to win. Now here, you have some hope, and I think Alexa will probably speak more to this. But what's encouraging is over the past few months, you consistently see that the current government would seriously lose if there was an election now, and that has only, to some degree, increased in some ways over the past few months, even from June until August, right? So they would fail to garner enough seats. The Likud party, the National Unity Party that Al-Mustafa was associated with, would jump to 28 seats, and Netanyahu's coalition would only take 52 seats, while the opposition parties would take 64 seats. So I won't get into, you know, all the breakdowns, but that's certainly encouraging. I won't go through all the details of that. What's interesting, and probably you'll get to this, is in terms of public opinion, you have just a little bit more, 36%, or 25% saying support a resumption of bids to pass the judicial overhaul, and 36% support stepping up the protests, 28%, most of the country wants compromise. Now this is encouraging in terms of the possibilities of the opposition, I think, coming back in the future, because the vast majority of the country, 70% or so, want some kind of consent. They don't want this judicial overhaul passed against, without a consensus among the opposition and those who are in the government. Yet it is the extremists of the government who refuse to compromise on anything, right? So the more that's kind of brought to bear, the more they might get some of the blame for that. Now when you compare Israel to places like Poland or Hungary, Hungary is no longer a democracy, and Poland is considered a semi-consolidated democracy. In Poland, the government has overhauled the judicial system in an unconstitutional way. The EU is trying to exert pressure on these countries and provide incentives to kind of bolster the liberal part of the democracy, or to kind of revitalize the liberal part of their democracies. But if you look at Israel, Israel gets a score of 77 out of 100 for its democracy, and Poland gets 81. So Poland scores better right now than the U.S. in some categories, and Hungary is lower. Now, if you break it down into what you're talking about in terms of democracy, Israel gets for electoral process 4 out of 4, political rights only 2 out of 4 because of the nation-state law that probably Professor Zinner will talk more about, 2 out of 4 in terms of corruption, and so forth. Now, interesting, out of the U.S., we have our own issues in the U.S., right? The U.S. Scores 83 out of 100. It's only a couple points above Poland overall, which is kind of interesting. And for the U.S., it gets a 3 out of 4 in terms of having an independent judiciary. So we're kind of, you know, falling, you know, have our own issues. And 3 out of 4 in terms of guaranteeing equal treatment before the law, 2 out of 4 for that. So in some of these categories, Israel, there are similarities between Israel and the U.S., but in others, of course, there are less threats to judicial review in the U.S. So I won't go into that. I'm going to quickly go into foreign policy for 2 minutes. and say that there are real kind of a real concern in terms of part of the security situation. Not only, although this might be interesting in the short term, are so many Israeli reservists saying we're not going to serve, you know, this kind of government that's not a democracy. What's interesting, even though most Israelis disagree with it, 30% of Israelis saying yes, that's okay, that's legitimate under the circumstances, right? So that's an interesting kind of figure, at least that came out in the polls. But also you have this deteriorating situation in the West Bank, where you have some in the government who want to annex and continue with the settlements and are provocateur. So a real concern of mine is that, you know, anytime something can escalate, and you can potentially get a real escalation, a further deeper escalation of violence that even could turn into a third intifada. So I think that that's something that's very much of concern. Iran is also supporting Islamic Jihad Gaza even more and trying to capitalize on that, as is the current government in its own way. And then if you look at U.S.-Israeli relations, if you've been looking at the news there, Biden is in a real spot in terms of how to try to influence Netanyahu, if there's any such thing, while still trying to challenge this government and so forth, and trying to build consensus. So as you will know, he hasn't invited him to the White House in the last 9 months, which is the first time that's happened, and apparently he's only going to see him on the side next week at the UN, but he's still not invited to the White House when he's in the United States. So the U.S. is trying to exert pressure. There's talk about perhaps normalization between Israel and Saudi Arabia, and both Saudi Arabia and the Biden administration are trying to say, yes, but you can't do this without making shutting the door to a two-state solution, which this current government is doing. And so perhaps because so many Israelis support normalization between Saudi Arabia and Israel, if the blame is put on Netanyahu and his government that they have failed to bring out this normalization because they're incapable of making progress in this way, that, in my optimistic nature, I'm trying to see some light at the end of the day, then there are those cracks that might lead to that, and I think a little also talk about current cracks that happen. So with that, I talked a little too long, I'll skip that.
Thanks so much, Yael. Thank you all for coming. Thanks for patience. I think that seeing even 35 minutes of unique personality, wisdom, humility of Aaron Barak is as good a validation of the way the Israeli judicial system has evolved and has entered the market. I don't think something like Aaron Barak would make it through the Senate confirmation hearings without the same kind of way. And it's, I say that because Israel is sort of facing a reckoning, constitutional reckoning. And even though Justice Barak was very, very public, I'd say he was sort of an apologist for Ben Gurion, the truth of the matter is that it was an Israeli children and said than they are today. We gather 2 days after Israel's Supreme Court had maybe, with some historians and experts, feel was maybe the most important historic hearing in its history. And it was a very, very interesting hearing, and I'm very grateful we have communications today. You can watch things over your site. Tune in for much of the debate and watch there. And there are a few things that are worth mentioning. The major question, I think, that if you distill it down to the theoretical essence is, what is democracy? Is it just rule by the majority, or are there other aspects which a healthy democracy has, which involves separation of powers, holding back a majority, granting guaranteeing rights to the voice and the like? And I think this is what we see here in the case where this is an appeal against the Knesset's decision to disqualify judicial review for unreasonable actions by the administration. The fact is that it seems to me that the Supreme Court is pretty solid on the fact that majority rule by itself. I think Justice Alito, who should be the next Chief Justice, if all goes well, about 2 or 3 months, said anybody who thinks that majority rule is everything should go back to junior high school. That's basically the nature of his thing. And he also said that democracies don't disappear in great, sort of small steps. And I think that slippery slope metaphor is going to carry. So I think this actually, if I'm looking at the outcome, certainly the immediate, I'm quite optimistic. And although Yael has presented a plausible or certainly a well-considered critique or a discouraging picture, I'm going to try to pick your spirits up a little bit because I'm a bit more optimistic. It's my nature. So on the plus side, when this government took over, the Israeli public was largely complacent, and that's how this government ended up getting a majority, because many Israelis, to give you an example, during the past election, the Israeli Philharmonic Orchestra was not in the country. We don't have absentee ballots, and I'm going to guess that most of those Tel Aviv residents, well, the cultured business, were not going to vote for the right-wing parties. And many, many friends I had just happened to have vacation, couldn't put it off. They didn't take Israel's democratic challenges seriously. That ain't gonna happen, at least not for the foreseeable future. Israelis are well aware of what's at stake here, and that's something that shaking the public out of the complacency is a very, very important thing. The present crisis has really been, I think, a tremendous boost for Israeli civic literacy. Israelis, if you talk from the street, from a cab driver to a falafel salesman to a professor, will have an opinion about the role of the Supreme Court, should they be activists, should they not, what are the roles of the minority, how Jewish should Jewish state be, issues that people maybe thought about when they had to take their high school civics test, but since then, largely put off. I think Israelis are not only thinking about it, but doing something about it. The fact that literally every Saturday night, I don't think that people are tired, I think it actually gives them something to do on Saturday night. All my friends have dinner options beforehand with their friends, you don't have to worry about it. You know, I have a social life, I've got the demonstration, I'm almost set. But I think it has done that, and it has transformed the political map. Let's remember, Israel had 4 consecutive elections in a year and a half break and another one. So during those elections, if you look at the numbers, and this present outcome was basically a perfect storm in terms of the center-left organization. So about 4.5-5% of the votes weren't even counted that would have gone for center-left parties. If that had been the case, it would not be enough to now government. So, today, as Yael mentioned, there has been a virtual, I would say, almost a tectonic shift. For the first time in years, as somebody who was out there trying to make that shift happen, and we see that the center left has a strong advantage in the polls, and many people who are sort of dividing themselves in right, certainly a third of the Likud voters, are now seeing the implications of having such a far-reaching government and deciding that something. And they see the price economically, in terms of Israel's reputation, and in terms of the soul of the country, how it really is tearing us apart. And a shout out to President Herzog, who's doing, I think, a wonderful job to try to hold this crazy package together. I would say another nice thing that I would like to about coming out, and that's the fact that it certainly, I think, speaks well for the role of women in Israel, because when I think about who saved Israeli democracy, there are 3 heroic women who get a big shout out, the first one being Esther Chaim, the Chief Justice, who has been a strong voice of calm, maturity, but unrelenting support for a active judiciary in that role, and she's been terrific. In fact, the government tried to delay the hearing, it was 2 days ago, because then she's supposed to retire, and she would have none of it, and she made that very clear. Gali Bahav-Miara, our Attorney General, who was really an unknown woman, and people misjudged the middle of the road. She was appointed by a right-wing Minister of Justice, Gideon Saab, has also withstood unbelievable pressures and actually stood up. She's the advised legal advice of the government, when the Supreme Court said, I cannot support this government's activity, which I believe is going to be critical in their decision, because the leading legal voice of the Israeli government has said, this is not acceptable. And last, a word out about a woman named Shikma Bressler, who in a normal day would just be a particle physicist working on, you know, fusion and things like that. And she took a leave from her job as a professor at the Weizmann Institute because she's just the only one who can do it, and has become the voice of the protest every Saturday night and is an inspiration to us all. And the final good thing that I think that's happened out of this last 7-8 months of turbulence is that the vast majority of Israelis with the center and left, who maybe would take a moment or two to put out an Israeli flag on Independence Day, but the flag as a symbol had been long ago hijacked by far-right elements who wanted to march the old city and stick it to the Palestinians and show them. Those days are gone. Today, the Israeli flag belongs to the protest for democracy. And there's nothing more exciting and inspiring than walking to the demonstration at Capitol in the Major at Saturday night, I think, the meeting, and if you can't park in your bike, tens of thousands of people there. And as you walk, you start to really reach there, more and more flags arrive. When you get there, there's a power. You understand why armies are marching to battle, running to battle with the flag, because there's something very, very important about the Zionists, I would say the same center of the middle, now the muscular middle, as I call it, reclaiming the flag as a symbol. Now, that doesn't mean that everything is good. So the negative side of everything is it ain't over yet. I believe that we're going to defeat this so-called legal reform, some people call it the government takeover. But it ain't over yet. And we still don't know. The government hasn't fallen yet. There's even Netanyahu is a very, very clever politician. And we'll see how that shakes out. And it has made, I would say, some irreversible damage, which would hope that irreversible will take a long time. First of all, it has politicized the judiciary, even though the judiciary tried very hard to stay away from it. Today, most Israelis will look at a given judge and say, was he an activist or was he left or then? And it's really a pity because for many years, there were many people in the Supreme Court who were right enough that nobody knew what their positions were. And now, certainly after the hearing 2 days ago, there was a listing of what everybody said, and from that they tried to decipher their views. So there's maybe 3 right wing judges, the rest are all not. But I think that's a little pity because I think the fact that we had an independent judiciary, there really was a as I saw, and the far right's insistence on making political, and even Netanyahu trying to do that as a way to escape his own indictments. The other thing that's so unfortunate is that many Israelis are looking ahead and say, okay, even if we win this round, demography is against us. The ultra-Orthodox are about a third of the first graders, 12 years from now, they're all going to vote. It won't take long. We'll be okay, but our kids are going to be very hard to live in a liberal democracy, and they're making other plans. Like I can say as an academic, around me, people asking me for advice. Where would you rather live, California or Connecticut? Those kind of questions that I hate to do that. And in general, the Supreme Court has lost a lot of its luster. To see Simcha Rotman, who's the head of the Judiciary Committee, go in there and insult the judges and call them elitists and oligarchs to their faces is something which had never been in the past. Even people who didn't like Supreme Court decisions would never. And I think that's a great shame. So to wrap up my comments, I would say, when I think about this, what's happened in the last 7-8 months, I go back to that maybe overused analogy of the frog and the boiling water. For those of you unfamiliar with this, it's a very famous environmental one where if you take a frog which has no internal thermostat and throw it into boiling water, it can sense major changes and hot water pop up. But if you take the same frog and put it in a lukewarm pot of water and then slowly but surely raise the fire on it, the frog boils to death. Can't feel the difference. And I think what happened to Israelis, the vast majority of Israelis, I'm not talking here only of secular, or anybody I think who is of a moderate spirit, who looks for the good of the country and unity, got thrown in the boiling water and saw a vision of how Israel could be and took the streets and said, no, we're going to double down on the country. And I'm very proud of Israel for doing that, and believe that the end, the forces of life, will triumph.
Is this safe from your mouth to that? Yeah. All right, well, time to follow along. Infectious optimism. And thank you again for organizing this panel and for bringing us together. Thank you for coming to talk about this really crucially important moment, Israel history. I will focus on the case that Alon mentioned briefly, the case that the Israel Supreme Court heard this Tuesday, described by many as perhaps the most consequential case in the court's 75-year history. The hearing lasted 13 and a half hours. It was live streamed. I was watching it on live stream many hours. All 15 justices of the court were present. This is unprecedented. The Israeli Supreme Court, unlike the American Supreme Court, doesn't usually sit in a complete panel. It sits in smaller panels, usually three, on very rare occasions, up to 11. This time, the Chief Justice ensured that everybody was present. They had to actually bring in additional chairs for that purpose. An issue was the constitutionality of the Knesset's recent repeal of the reasonableness doctrine, which is a doctrine which allowed the judicial review to invalidate, void decisions of the government, decisions of ministers for extreme unreasonableness. This law, which was passed in July of this year, is the only part of the judicial overhaul to have actually been enacted until now. Immediately after the reasonableness doctrine was abolished, the movement for the protection of democratic Israel, the Association for Civil Rights, Yesh Atid, the leading opposition party, and a host of other individuals and groups filed petitions before the Supreme Court challenging the law. The claim, in a nutshell, is that without reasonableness review, there will be no meaningful constraints on corrupt appointments, on the dismissal of officials, notably the Attorney General, on interference with elections, and that, in fact, a host of essential elements of Israeli democracy are consequently at risk. In most instances, the Attorney General represents the government, as hopefully you saw in the interview with Chief Justice Barak. He described the office of the Attorney General as being a non-political office. But this time, it's not the Attorney General who is representing the government because she agrees with the petitioners. Instead, the government hired a private attorney to represent it. In the time that I have left, I'm going to try to outline what the legal issues that before the court are, and they're quite complicated, and what are the alternative scenarios. So the first thing that needs to be understood here is that the reasonableness review provision was repealed through an amendment to a basic law. And hopefully you gathered from the description of Chief Justice Bogue what a basic law is, right? So to recap, there's no comprehensive constitution in Israel, such as exists in the United States. There are 13 basic laws which have a quasi-constitutional status. They include laws dealing with the structure of the government, the Knesset, the judiciary, a law that establishes Jerusalem as the capital of the state, a law protecting human dignity and liberty, that's the law that Chief Justice Barak emphasized, and most recently, a basic law defining Israel as a nation state of the Jewish people. The Supreme Court determined in the 1990s, in what Chief Justice Barak described as the constitutional revolution, that the court had the authority to invalidate regular legislation when it contradicts a basic law. That was the example that he gave with respect to the Kaadan case, referred to as the Katsir case, that involved
that invalidated restrictions on Arabs who applied to live in Jewish communities. So the principle was established during that time that the court, the Supreme Court, could invalidate legislation, regular legislation, when it conflicts with the basic law. But does the judicial authority, the judicial review authority, also extend to a situation where we have a basic law that is at issue? Can the Supreme Court find that a basic law is unconstitutional? And to recall the way in which an unreasonableness doctrine was repealed was through a change to a basic law. Now, the conundrum that the court faces here follows from the fact that the government's answer to the question is an emphatic no. The government argues that in enacting a basic law, the Knesset exercised its authority as a constituent assembly representing the sovereignty of the people. And what right does the court have to step in? And the analogy here is to a hypothetical unconstitutional amendment in the United States. Can you argue that if the Constitution was amended, that it is contradictory to the Constitution? I think this is an important argument. It's not an argument that can be easily dismissed. But there is also an important counter-argument, and it points to the ease with which basic laws are enacted. Amending the American Constitution is very difficult. Proposal for amendment must come from 2/3 of the states. It has to be ratified by 3/4 of the state legislature, which also comes from 2/3 of both houses of Congress. It is a very difficult process, and there have been, for that reason, very few amendments. In Israel, by contrast, there is no difference procedurally between how a basic law and a regular law are passed. Some basic laws are amended with a simple majority, others require a vote of 61 members out of a total of 120. That still means that there's no need for anybody from the opposition to vote for the basic law. And indeed, the repeal of the unreasonableness review passed the Knesset in a vote of 64-0. All members of the opposition boycotted the vote. The court, until now, has never invalidated the basic law. Will it this time? It addressed the question directly, most directly, in 2021, in the context of a challenge to the constitutionality of the basic law that I briefly mentioned, the nation state of the Jewish, Israel as a nation state of the Jewish people, which I hope to hear a lot more to be said about. The petitioners argue that the law should be voided as unconstitutional, in part due to its failure to ensure equal rights to non-Jewish minorities. The Supreme Court rejected the petition. It rejected the petition in a vote of 10-1. And the main opinion was written by Chief Justice Chayyut, the same Chief Justice who is currently making the decision. And she said she did not think that the law should be voided. She was very hesitant to allow for invalidation of the basic laws unconstitutional. But she did leave the door open for a possibility that the court will find basic law to be unconstitutional when it counters the essence of Israel as a Jewish and democratic state. She didn't identify what that would be, but that was the circumstance, the hypothetical situation. The petitioners, and most importantly, the Attorney General, believe that this is indeed such a case. The Attorney General has said that not only does the court have the authority to do so, but there is no alternative but doing so, because in the absence of reasonableness review, there would be no protections against government activity thwarting the independence of gatekeepers, threatening election, for example, enacting a law prohibiting air parties from running in the elections. So that's where things stand. That is the conundrum. what are the options going forward? Well, one is that there will be some kind of political compromise, and including perhaps some unilateral withdrawal by the government that will remove this hot potato from the court. Another is that the court will invalidate the law on procedural grounds, which apparently there are some claims that there were procedural errors that could send it back to the Knesset. Another sort of related claim is that the case is not right, there needs to be actually a concrete situation where reasonableness is not yet applied. But then there's a nuclear option, outright invalidation of repeal and reasonableness doctrine, as the Attorney General believes the court ought to do. Will the government comply? Netanyahu has been ambiguous about it. On the eve of the hearing, the Speaker of the Knesset, Amir Ohana, of the Likud party, held a press conference in which he said that a court decision to uphold the petitions could plunge us into the abyss, and that the Knesset won't submissively allow itself to be trampled. Netanyahu retweeted these comments. Timing of the decision. Chayit is retiring on the 16th of October. She has to retire. There's compulsory retirement at age 70 in Israel. She has 3 months to write the opinion after she retires, so the final deadline is January 12th. In any event, there's not going to be a decision over the next 3 weeks because the parties have an opportunity to submit additional affidavits. Meanwhile, this morning, in a separate but related case, the Supreme Court, acting by this time by an ordinary three-judge panel, required the Minister of Justice, Yair Levine, to explain his refusal to convene the Judicial Selection Committee, about which you heard in the interview with Chief Justice Barak. Levine has not convened the committee since January, keeping multiple vacancies open. He does not want to convene the committee because he wants the law regarding the composition of the committee to change. In particular, he wants the successor to Chayut not to be Justice Amit, a liberal, but he has other candidates. Levine's view is that the court does not have the authority to second-guess his decision not to convene the committee, but that's within his discretion. In ordering him to give reasoning, the court signaled today that it will actually inquire into this decision. And they will hear the case this coming Tuesday. So, stay tuned.
Thank you, Professor Dean and Professor
Zagat. Go at the end. Sorry about that.
15, 20.
Talking to you about the different perspectives, talking about judicial reform, or others who call it regime change. We'll talk a little bit about supporters and opponents to these actions. We will start with looking at a few pictures. Ask yourself if you can maybe tell what each one of those protests tell us. Where does this come from, maybe? Does this correspond a little bit with those who support or maybe oppose the protests? Just think about it for just a few more seconds. And what we see here is on the up left side of this slide, you see one of the many protests against reform happening in Kaplan, one of the junctures in Tel Aviv. This is a picture from week number 26, which is in July. I think now we're in week number 35 or something like this. Sorry if I'm mistaken about that. Yes, hundreds of thousands of Israelis have been going to the streets, not just in Tel Aviv, but in other cities, in Haifa, and Jerusalem, and other places, protesting against think about who are those people who go there. Do they represent the entire mix-up of the Israeli society, and that we'll be arguing a little bit later on that it's not. It's very much hopeful that we have so many people going to the streets, but those are coming from specifically one major group in Israeli society. Does not represent all of them. On opposition to them, you have here and there, it's not the same intensity as those who are against the reforms. There are also some protests on the right up side of the slide. There are some protests that are in favor of these reforms. People are calling for the government to go ahead and just finish the job. What they want is what exactly the government is leading. And you can see here the use of Israeli flag. It was referred to by Professor Khan previously. That's true. That was made by decision. And the one against the reform, they are also using the Israeli flag. I think that they are using it too much to an extent that is excluding the Arabs from these protests. We talk about this just in a second. So you see over there the Israeli flag. You see some language in Hebrew, but also in English, because they do want the support from the outside of Israel. They do want the support of the Jewish diaspora to support them. They do want the support of external, other governments, such as the Biden administration and other European countries, to support them in their quest to preserve Israel as it is, with its complexities. Even though it's not full democracy, at least keep it as is. It's better than where the government is taking us. The two pictures at the bottom of the slide tell the story of why the others, some of the others in Israel, who are not participating in this. The picture on the left side, the bottom left side, is from a protest that was introduced as the March of the Dead, happening in the Habima Square in Tel Aviv, in August this last summer. And it was mainly organized by Arab citizens of the state of Israel, Arab NGOs, and Arab politicians. They were protesting what's happening in the street, on the streets in Arab localities in the last year or so. It hasn't happened more than that, but in the last year, crime is widespread. The government is not doing a lot about that. The police is not doing a lot about that. As of last time that I checked, a few days ago, it's 175 Arab citizens of the state have been killed in these fights between mobs, without having any breakthrough of stopping all of what's happening in these Arab localities, which is already almost twice the number of the Arab residents in Israel that have been killed in the previous year, and the previous year was already an increase. So many of the Arabs, I will get to some of the reasons why they are not participating. One of the major reasons that they are not participating in these protests against the reforms is that they are already preoccupied with this public security issue. The other picture over here on the right, bottom right end of the slide, is a picture from a protest held by the Jews of the Golan Heights about protesting the wind turbines project in the Golan Heights. So why the Jews in the Golan Heights have a very special circumstances? The majority of them don't have to consider themselves as Israelis, they are Syrians. Let's leave that aside. It does show us as a tip of an iceberg of a larger issue happening within the Jewish community that is tied to the issue of ownership of lands, planning, and housing, that are Jewish people preoccupied with that rather than being preoccupied with protesting against the regime change or the reform. We'll get to more reasons why the Jews are not participating by the end of this presentation. Let me offer you some background and maybe collect some of the points that were presented earlier by Professor Aronoff, Professor Dahl. When we talk about these differences in terminology, some people calling it reform, some others talking about regime change. Each one of those is coming from a different perspective. Those on the right, the religious far side, are claiming that the justices and the Supreme Court already went too far away. They have forgotten that Israel is a Jewish state. They have ruled in favor of the liberal side of the state of Israel, the Ba'adan case that was mentioned in the movie, or the Katsir, the same case, abolishing the law that gave exemption for the Haredi people to serve in the army, just to mention two cases. And the left wing would say that Israel is okay, is managing the Jewish and democratic, and we can argue we're distributing Israel, but we want to keep it as is and not to change it. If you take the scholarly discourse about the situation in Israel, you will find many, many publications about that. That would, I would like to use this simplistic way of looking at comparing countries and the types of regimes that they have. So on the one hand, I would use the liberal democracy format, the US, Germany, Japan, other countries worldwide. On the other end of that is authoritarian regimes, those that are dictatorships. Okay, you think about a president that is ruling by decree, think about the army taking power of the country. And there are multiple cases throughout history, Latin America, there are more contemporary examples such as Iran or Saudi Arabia. And in between, political scientists would introduce to us that there are some kind of hybrid regimes or illiberal democracies. The question is, where do we situate Israel even before these changes are happening? So even before this is happening, you have scholars disagree with one. Some would say Israel is a liberal democracy. It does have some problems, such as the same as the US has. And we do say that the US is a liberal democracy. But some would say, well, what about abortion rights? Does that disqualify or not? Still, the US is considered to be a liberal democracy. What about the refugee status in Germany? Does that disqualify Germany from being labeled as a liberal democracy? No. So the same thing, those scholars argue, Israel is the same thing, it does have some problems. They might be fixed, they might not be fixed, but still Israel is a liberal democracy. On the other end of that, there's a group of scholars who would say that Israel was already on the verge of being labeled as an authoritarian regime, at least in everything that is in connection to the status of the Palestinians in the West Bank and the Gaza Strip, and also for the citizens, Arab citizens that live inside the state of Israel, and many other groups that are disenfranchised. In the middle between them, two schools of thought, one saying that Israel was maybe going to become a liberal democracy, but that process had stopped. If some things are fixed, such as having a constitution that is now missing, such as withdrawing from the West Bank, drawing borders, those fixed, Israel will become a liberal democracy. Another model in the middle is saying that Israel will never become a liberal democracy. It's already a non-liberal democracy, and it's going to stay as such. My own scholarship, all of my publications that are relevant to this topic, would signal to me supporting this claim, that Israel is already a non-democratic, non-liberal democratic state. It is a democratic, it has some baggage of some rights that are offered, that's true, but it's not a complete liberal democracy, and will never become so because of this tension between being Jewish and being democratic state. Once those exist, and once Israel has no separation of religion and state, among other things, Israel would stay as a liberal democracy. But now, I would argue that with these changes happening, would actually push Israel much more to that column of being an authoritarian regime. When you eliminate almost all of those checks and balances between the three branches of power, eliminating the opportunity for the judicial system to exercise the reasonableness test against those decisions, so you push Israel much more to that. So this is about terminology, and those who are against the reform, such as myself, would say that this is actually a regime change. Those on the right wing would say that, well, we are just fixing what's not working right now in terms of our perspective. And here I think I would differ with the other speakers here. I think Israel was already on the path for these changes. We just did not see the signs. So yes, there are some triggers that just caused it to happen right now. This is why I call them the triggers. It's the combination of some demographic changes and shifts in political trajectory. More Israelis are tending to the right. More Haredi people are being born, and they usually support their own political parties, Shas and Yehudit Torah. And they will continue to do that because most of their kids go to the schools that are controlled by these two parties. But not just them, all of other social parts of the Israeli mix. So that just culminated now. It could have happened just in 5 years or 10 years from now, but it would have happened. also than in the non-corruption cases. It's just a matter of timing that now Netanyahu was able to play the political system, wait for the five different campaigns of elections until he got his majority that he wanted. And he wants to avoid time and jail. So it's, those are the triggers, but we already have those underlying causes that already were preparing us that we eventually will go there. Israel will go there. I cannot make any predictions of what's going to happen with the Supreme Court next week, or what's going to happen in the political system next month or next year. Maybe there will be a pause to that, maybe we'll wait a little bit, maybe some of those changes will not happen now. Eventually they will happen. And these are the causes for that. We do not have a written, formal, inflexible and supreme constitution. If we do not have that, that's a major problem. We will keep those discussions happening. If we're not able to make those compromises, we will hit this problem once again in a year, in 2 years, in 10 years from now. When we compare countries from one another, one of the things that we want to see in a constitution is that it's all of these things that are written over there. That it's written, it's formal, it's flexible, and it's supreme. None of those applies to Israel in the basic laws agenda. Then the definition of the state as Jewish and democratic. Once this is not defined, so Justice Aharon Barak suggested his own interpretation. Let's have the definition of Jewish as abstract as possible. I like his definition. The problem is that the majority of the Jewish Israelis do not like that. Shas and Yehudot HaTorah do not want that. They want to see Israel as much as possible more religious. And when I say more religious in the Israeli context, is more Orthodox, Jewish Orthodox school of thought. It's not progressive. It's not reform, all of the things that you know of the Jewish communities here in the United States. These do not exist in Israel. When we talk in Israel that they want the state to be Jewish, they talk about Orthodox Judaism, or Orthodox Judaism. Religious Zionism Party, they also want some form of extremism in that regard, and they want to see Israel less democratic, more Jewish. And if you keep going all of these political camps in Israel, you'll find that the minority would keep what Justice Barak wanted, keeping the definition of the state Jewish in its abstract way. This is the problem here, and we cannot solve it right now. And then we have tribalism in Israeli society. There's a very famous speech by President Rivlin in 2015 that is called the Four Tribes speech. And he said, well, we tried in the very first years of the state of Israel to establish the melting pot of policy. We wanted to create a new Jew. We wanted to create the new Israeli, to have the gathering of the exiles coming from Europe, from the Middle East, from North Africa, from the Americas, coming into Israel, creating one united Israeli society. It was a policy. President Rivlin acknowledged in 2015, we have failed. It was not successful. Instead of that, we have created four separate tribes in Israeli society. There is the secular Jewish one, there is the national religious Jewish one, and there is the Orthodox one. And the fourth one is the Arab Israelis. These are separated from one another. They are separated in housing in most of the cases. They are separated in the education streams. Each one of their kids go to separate schools. And in one of my ongoing research that I'm still doing is that they would argue that there is another layer beneath that, that you would incorporate the idea of Israel as a deeply divided society and incorporating the six major divides in Israeli society, the national, the ethnic, the religious, socioeconomic, and gender divide. If we incorporate all of that, we can create a map of Israeli society, which would say that each one of those subgroups or sub-tribes, some scholars have argued against my term of using the idea of sub-tribes, but nevertheless, subgroups, each one of them actually operates separately from the others. The Russian Jews in Israel operate their political behavior separately from others. The Ethiopian Jews, the same thing. The Druze in Israel are separate from the majority of the Arabs who are Muslims, and Christians are a little bit differently. And when we do such a research on the voting booth in Israel, and we can attach for each voting booth to the zip code where people live there, and we know the demographics, we can attach each one of those subgroups to a political party. And when we operate in such a way, And we can include to that some of the demographic changes that are happening in Israel, where the Arab tribe is rising, and mainly those are the Muslim, Sunni Muslim Arabs, specifically among them Bedouins, but not just them. And we look at the Haredi who are also rising in the demographics, and each one of them will keep voting for their own parties. And the only tribe that is shrinking in Israeli polity is the one that does is the Ashkenazi Jews. So you wonder why the Labour Party and Meretz have not been getting enough votes, and Meretz is out of the Knesset for the first time since 1990. But this is the trajectory. It's inherited within the makeup of Israeli society, the social structure and the attachment of the political parties to that. And then we have talk about the role of the Supreme Court and judicial review. Did they really get by the legislator such a definition that gave them the authority to do the judicial review? And some would argue that they did not get that. There is a time now to define what is the role of the Supreme Court in doing such a thing. So some implications about that, and I think there are other scholars on the panel that are more experts than myself to talk about some of these things. But my argument here is that once some of these changes are enacted, they might or might not affect some of the things that I mentioned here: U.S.-Israel relations with the Jewish diaspora, relations with the EU and European countries individually, Arab countries and Israel, Israel's economy might be affected or not, Netanyahu trials might be affected. You can argue in favor, more or less might be affected. I would say all of these might be affected marginally. The U.S. is not going to abandon Israel. Israel is more important than what they think to Israel, to U.S. interests. Arab countries are, most of them are dictatorships. They do not care about the level of democracy that Israel has. The Jewish diaspora, what other choice do they have? Would they stand to oppose the only Jewish state in the country? Yeah, some of them might think, well, we will support Israel less. But would they stand against Israel in the UN or in other places? Would they vote for candidates in the US elections that would actively work against the state of Israel? I doubt it. Israel's economy, yeah, it's going to suffer a little bit. It's not going to be the same developed economy that it has been in the past. It's not going to be developed as much. Yeah, it's going to be downgraded. You're waiting for the official doctor today, 3 months in Israel, you maybe wait for 6 months later on if some of those hundreds of doctors saying we were going to leave this to come. Maybe. So who is going to be affected? The ones that are not protesting. The ones that are going to be affected the most are the Arab students of the state of Israel. They have been marginally protected by the Supreme Court. They have been discriminated against throughout Israel's history, with some good changes happening in the last 10 or 15 years. That's going to stop. They are going to be affected the most. And then think about the rights of other minorities in Israel. Women?
Not a minority, by the way.
Say again?
Not a minority in Israel.
Well, women in Israel are a minority, not by the numbers of people, but if you look at how women are underrepresented in the Knesset, the maximum that ever we got in the Knesset was a third of the members of the Knesset. Today is much less. The number of women who held positions as ministers, and now it's much less than it was before. The number of prime ministers, only one. So in political representation, it's less. Even at the local level, same thing as mayors and council members, even less. But the rights of women on the spectrum, religious rights, in the household, marriages and divorce, and how they are affected by the fact that Israel has religious courts that decide these kind of things. LGBT community, migrants in Israel, and the major effect that I suspect will be is on the Israeli-Palestinian conflict. Today, before these changes happen, if the Israeli government, any Israeli government, decides to annex the West Bank, just to give an example, the Supreme Court might stop them on the grounds of, okay, if you're going to annex the West Bank, you must grant full citizenship to the 4 million Palestinians living over there. The current government, obviously, and any other government, would not want to do that. They would want to annex the West Bank without doing this. So in the current format, the Supreme Court would argue, this is not a democratic action. if you are annexing without giving them the rights, for example, to vote to the Knesset. Okay? Once these changes happen, the Supreme Court will not have any authority to tell the government that you must stop and you have no authority to continue with annexing to West Bank without giving these rights. I would like to end, and I hope I still have 2 minutes, with a list of things that might explain why the Arab Palestinians and why the Jews have abstained from protesting against them. I'm trying to do that in some graphics, but I think I have just 3 pages of just text to myself. I will just mention a few of those. When I asked a colleague, an Arab, a Muslim, a scholar in the field, when I was in the summer in Israel, why do you think your community is not protesting? He said the following. When a Jewish Israeli asked me about this, I said, I told him the following. No democracy in Israel? Well, welcome to the club. We already do not have democracy in Israel, so things are not changing for us. There's not an encouragement for them to go and protest. Another one said to me the following. This is an internal fight between the Jews. We are not welcomed over there. And they cited the idea that there are too many flags over there, an Israeli flag that is not welcoming to them, coming from Jewish origin and Jewish history. I'm talking about the idea that Herzog, who is really doing a very good job, I agree. But the fact that Herzog, the Israeli president, did not find it appropriate to invite the Arab politicians in the Knesset for those negotiations is not welcoming to the Arabs in Israel. So they are excluded. So that man, that old man that told me this is an internal fight between the Jews, I think he's right. If he sees Herzog, the Israeli president, calls for the right-wing parties, for the left-wing parties, come to the table to negotiate the future of the state of Israel, and who's not there? The Arab representatives. Nobody is there. Nobody is invited. So are we asking really why the Arabs are not protesting? So Arab Palestinians are already preoccupied by other pressing things. I didn't mention in the beginning the idea of the crime wave, with 175 Arabs being killed. They have problems with this discrimination against them in terms of budgets for the localities. And they have a problem with the judicial system as well. Yes, it did provide some protections here and there. The Katsir case that was mentioned, the Adan case, or other cases where the Supreme Court is actually the one that defends the rights of Arab politicians to run for office. Even when the Knesset disqualified them, the Supreme Court is the one that allows them to run for office. That's true. But where was the Supreme Court in defending them in regard, for example, for Arab family reunions? Do you know that Israel does not allow an Arab person from Israel to get married to a Palestinian from the West Bank? And allowing that spouse from the West Bank to come and become an Israeli citizen and live in Israel, that is banned, it's not allowed. And the Supreme Court decided that this law is legal, it's constitutional. And they would say that, what is the Supreme Court in relation to the unrecognized Bedouin communities in the Negev? The Supreme Court decided that even though they are not recognized, they do not deserve to get those services and having, for example, voting booths in their own locality. They need to travel an hour and a half where they don't have public transportation, they don't have roads, their kids go to schools by walking 25 or 30 minutes, and so on and so on. The Supreme Court did not interfere in all of those, so why do we need to go to protest to protect the Supreme Court? What about the Jews? The Jews had a different story. And the story, I think, would go this way. We are disappointed from the 2018 Nation State Basic Law was this. But a stab in the back. Yes. Defining the state as a Jewish state and not defining it as Jewish and democratic, disregarding anyone who's not Jewish, was a stab in the back for the Jews, people who saw themselves as, first of all, Israelis, and after all, anything else. We appealed, so the Jews would argue, we appealed to the Supreme Court, as mentioned earlier, and the Supreme Court did not interfere to cancel that law and ask the Knesset to appeal. So they are already dissatisfied with the Israeli political system. They also have the problem of some lands and planning and housing that I mentioned earlier. And so they are very much preoccupied with other things. Yes, some Jews here and there, you'll find them in the protest, maybe in Haifa, which is much closer to the Galilee or Mount Carmel, but this is not representative of the majority of the Jews. I visited myself, my own hometown, in Galilee del Carmel. When I talked about that with my family members or others, they would say, we do not care. I explained that, well, we are going to be affected the most by these changes. The minimum of those protections that exist today, which are not enough, but still at least this exists, that would be gone. This still does not convince many of them to go to protest. Thank you so much for listening.
Within them, but it certainly is an apparent contradiction. What's interesting, another statistics that I didn't bring up when I was here in terms of public opinion, is that many people who voted for some of the parties in this current government voted it partially because of the May 2021 war between Israel and Hamas, and then the intercommunal aspects that happened, and the social media covering, let's say, for Ben-Gvir's supporters, only the news as victims, in these cases which definitely were, but didn't also kind of in their social media show, Arab Israelis as being victims of some of these models, obviously the vast majority of Jewish or Muslim Israelis did not, weren't violent in any way during this, but it was a sense of kind of loss of personal security and a fear that this government could provide more support. So it's interesting, yes, you have 62% or so saying, identifying as right wing, but the majority of Israelis polled this month, including the right, say that they don't find the security situations having improved necessarily, both externally, let's say, if you look at conflicts with in Gaza and so forth and the West Bank, or internally in terms of communal conflicts. So I can, if you want to look at the particular statistics of each group that I have here, but in that sense, you have, and as I said, 30% of the right sometimes participating in these demonstrations. So you have even within the right, sections of the right, saying, hey, the cost is too high here, right, in terms of extreme polarization of society, in terms of economic effects, where you have less investment in Israel, you have, as Professor said, doctors thinking about leaving, you have inflation rising, so that economically, security-wise, right, where you have reservists refusing to serve and be called up, you have the regional potential implications of, in terms of U.S.-Israeli relations, potential implications of not being able to normalize Saudi Arabia. So all these costs become visible, and even the ultra-Orthodox themselves, right, are saying, the backlash might hit us in terms of being drafted into the military, which the majority of Israelis, again, in terms of public opinion, want. So you do have this you know, whether it's a contradiction or not, certainly there's a contradiction of people voting for the current government because they think it'll improve their security, yet a significant amount of people not seeing the effects that they were expecting from that or hoping for that. So in terms of Alon's optimism, I usually try to be optimistic in the end, that leaves hope, right, that if you can see a combination of circumstances, even though in the long term, really not accurately depicts concerning trends of underlying causes, but you could have such a deep backlash that Professor Tao also talks about that really could have not just an immediate effect, but perhaps have a more sustained effect in terms of preventing a continued deterioration of democracy. I don't know if anybody else wants to address that at all.
Thank you very much for the panel. I really appreciate the perspective, especially having done study about this year in Israel and seeing the protests and seeing the marches and being actually at the Supreme Court on the day of the decision to remove the I had the two with the group that very day. That was very impressive. Two things that kind of came up at me, you know, I do follow this quite. A secular person, quite religiously. There's two things that are coming at me here that I think are important to discuss in the context of the anti-Bogue movement. One thing is, it's amazing to me that the great white hope of democracy in Israel is Saudi Arabia, which is actually the opposite of democracy or anything that you can imagine. The democracy, and we're hoping that this will convince Netanyahu to back down from policies, I think that's, I'm afraid that's false hope. But the other part of this is, I think that a lot of, and this is something that came up with my students this summer, students seem to think that young people tend to be more liberal than older people. And actually in Israel, unlike here in the United States where education has been trending more liberal, let's say the last 30 years as a trend, maybe not in the last 3 or 4 years, of how this, since, you know, book bannings and things that were happening here. But by and large, most of our students come from schools that do see them, the education they provide as liberal education, that enshrines diversity, for example, that looks at inclusion as a very positive thing. Whereas in Israel, actually, the systems, the educational systems, and I'm not saying one system, because there are multiple systems, are actually exclusionary. They are not inclusive. There's one, maybe one that's supposed to be inclusive, and even that is not, for example, inclusive of our students. So is there a future with such an educational system for dreams of a democratic state that can be vibrant, that can allow people to move between groups, for example, that can allow relationships between groups, or is that just a dead end?
It is true that Israeli young people, particularly after they serve in the military, tend to move to the right, and at least in the secular tribe, as they go to the university, they say, swing back to the left. I have 3 daughters who follow that pattern very closely. I would say this. We tend to deal and address the others monolithically. For example, the ultra-Orthodox. This is a very complicated society. So I give an example. Everybody was furious at Netanyahu because one of the achievements of the previous government was to convince certain of the major Hasidic sects to adopt a secular core curriculum, which included math, science, and civics, okay? And as part of the coalitional deal, that expectation was eliminated. However, the Rebbe, the spiritual leader of the second largest Hasidic group in Israel, that was just announced, well, we want those core subjects, we want our people to become more integrated in the economic market, and we realize that there's a problem with the present business model of the ultra-Orthodox community. So those kind of changes are also happening. And I think that when we look at the Israeli map, we forget that for so long, for example, who was against initially any kind of annexation of the West Bank was the religious Zionists. They were moderates. The ultra-Orthodox wanted just peace, okay? And still, very famous decision by the spiritual leader Shas said we should create land for peace. It's not a problem. And so I don't see Bibi Netanyahu is without a doubt the most gifted politician we've had in Israeli history. And one of his great achievements was to create the so-called natural partners bloc that always voted with the right. But I think that what's happened in this tectonic shift that I talked about, that is now ruptured. And the fact that the religious science is so extreme creates a vacuum for most religious science who are not that way, who don't hate Arabs, who are not racist, and who are looking for something else. So I'm hopeful that we will see a major shifting switch. And the final thing I want to say is, and this is a response to Professor Zidar, ultimately, if we want to really have a liberal Israeli state and change the map, we need to have some kind of accommodation with the Palestinians, because as long as the West Bank and Stas defines your political identity, then they're going to have this false right. In fact, most Israelis on the right are actually pretty socialist in their how they want governments and the kind of safety net they want. So I think that I don't think we should lock ourselves into present trends as ineluctable. And we know that there has been major shifts in Israel, and I believe there will be.
I'm more of a pessimist side of the panel, but I think there is hope. It will depend on resolving the occupation problem. And until Israel deals with this, I don't know that we can actually. I'm sorry, I said that there is hope, but it depends on resolving the occupation. And the dilemma of protest movement has been how much to highlight or not the occupation. I think there are divisions within it. When I went to a demonstration on my visit this summer, there was a group, there always are those groups of young, not so young people who are protesting within the protests themselves, reminding the protesters about the occupation. It's the union against the occupation, that's the closest I can find it. So I think that's really, what Alon was saying is that it needs to be a resolution with the Palestinians. And I think this is really bringing this to the fore. I think that's where the future depends.
Anybody else? Or
Yeah.
Okay.
Hi, so I wasn't exactly sure what to ask sort of along these lines, but it is somebody, especially I spent the summer with, I think, a lot of what people would call sort of the ultra-Orthodox. And so I've gotten a lot of their side and a lot of experience, working with them and studying with them. And so I feel like people lump this ultra-Orthodox, I think is, Dr. Kell said that, lump it and talk about it as some other, and in a way, demonize it in a way that I think sometimes takes away from a little bit of the productive conversation about some of the issues that they're pushing for and they're facing. So what would you say about a kind of decoupling of the issues of, people also addressing some of the problems on the Orthodox side while also, not supporting the judicial reform? I don't know if that makes sense, but
it certainly seems like one of the priorities for, I don't know if the Orthodox, even though we are kind of for these purposes choosing as a group despite the diversity, is not being drafted into the military. And so my sense of it is that if they prioritize that to a much higher degree than other kind of judicial reforms, and we possibly be willing to compromise on those. So in that sense, there's a possibility under certain conditions, under certain circumstances, perhaps that they would even fault the government if it was an issue that they would have to be drafted in terms of their multiple priorities. The problem is that when we look at public opinion, most Israelis support the draft. I don't know if anyone else wants to.
I have a lot to say about it because I'm limited to 30 seconds. The universal conscription into either a national service or the army. And Benny Gantz was the Minister of Defense, spent many, many hours hammering out agreements quietly with the ultra-Orthodox religious leadership. Not that these people go to the army, they do a national service, they work with ambulances, and then everybody at the age of 18 becomes the president. One of the best, the worst kept secrets in Israel is only 50% of people at age 18 do national service. That's unsustainable. Because the same people who are doing national service, the ones who are paying all the taxes, and they're the ones who want to leave now. And so we have to find a solution to that. And there was a willingness, and that's one of the many great tragedies. And incidentally, whenever Arab Israelis say that they're, you know, don't feel that they've lost democracy, well, the government fell because of an Arab member of merits. But that's why we don't have a...
I disagree.
Well, I was there, and I can tell you that exactly that's what happened. And I'm not, you know, saying that was the representing the full Arab community. I'm just saying that Arabs have a very ability to influence, and if they voted up to their percentages, it would have greater influence. They would actually be able to decide in the government.
I would connect to this idea of the role of the arms. So let's just remember, arms have been this way, maybe. So Arabs in Israel, Arab citizens in Israel, do you have the right to vote since the first elections in January 1949? Do you have their own representation in the Knesset? Not freely elected and under the martial law of Arab localities in 1966. That was not free elections. It was dictated by Mapai to some extent. They did develop it around the 1960s, 70s, and then started to introduce their own political parties in the 1980s. And up to today, we have four major parties that operate within the Arab political mandate. The first ever Arab political party to be invited to be part of the coalition of the government happened just in Israel. Okay? With 75 years of Israel's history. So they have been outside of the political game. They were just introduced to it just 2 years ago and did not have that experience enough. So Ram, which is, I think, was the worst choice that could have happened, to choose only Ram, the United Arab List, which represents the Islamic movement in Israel, which is, to some extent, a copy of Shas and the Dutta Bara, but not for the Jews, for the Muslim Arabs. To choose them to be part of the coalition, that was, I think, a mistake, but nevertheless, they were introduced to the government, they were part of the government for 1 year and a half, and my interpretation of why the last government fell, which was that as the change government, is not because of those very few Arab members of the coalition. You mentioned one from Meretz, some would argue against some members of United Arab List. I think it was because the members of the party of the Prime Minister. The Prime Minister was Naftali Bennett from the extreme right wing, with 7 seats. Already at the beginning of his government, he lost one member because he could not support that, so he left with 6. Once again, it's the Prime Minister. And members of his own party, out of the 6, were against his decisions to be in the coalition, in the Knesset, sorry, in the cabinet, with Arab members as part of the coalition. So now blaming those Arab representatives as if they are to blame.
Oh, I wasn't about blaming. I was speaking specifically that one Arab thing made the difference. And yet.
And also two from the party.
Oh, yeah.
The same vote. Two from the members of the party of Natalia. If you take that vote, if you're referring to that vote specifically. So they did not vote in favor of their own government. So we are blaming once again the Arabs. And I think that is a mistake. And I think that we can do better. And I did provide some less optimistic overview. I think we can do still with that perspective. We could end up with Israel being more autocratic, more as a dictatorship than it could be. So there's a lot of, what I'm trying to say is that there's a lot of options that could happen from where Israel is situated now to where it could end. So the protests, yes, they were successful in imposing some of this legislation. They delayed some of the legislation. And we could continue to do that and at least have Israel, if it's going to deteriorate its level of democracy, it could deteriorate just a little bit and not the whole spectrum to the end of being not a democracy and a world democracy. So there's still some hope for doing some things in the next few months and few years to save some of the elements of Israel as a democracy.
I want to add, in continuing with a more optimistic vision is that the precedent of including an Arab member in the previous government, it did create a crisis, but it created the precedent. And that has happened. And I think the door was opened for this to happen in the future in a much greater way. It's probably the key to reforming
college. Yeah, and to support that, there, you know, you have Netanyahu and others on the right criticizing the coalition of Bennett for having this Islamist Israeli party in it. But Netanyahu, at different times in the past, after that, was trying to recruit him. Now people on the right and left are trying to recruit him. So I think you're right, that taboo, at least, has been very much weakened, if not broken. And so there is opportunities, and the center left all along sometimes, in order to really form a coalition, has needed to include Arab parties, and for a variety of reasons, that has not happened, but perhaps that could be more likely a window in the future for that to happen. In terms of the latest poll this month, again, Ra'am, this party that we talked about, would get 6 seats. The Lod, just like in the election in November, wouldn't pass, and this time the Labour Party wouldn't pass, which is interesting after 9 months of demonstrations, that the Meretz party would get apparently 4 seats and Labour nothing. So kind of interesting implications, but Ra'am still doing relatively well. Any other questions, comments? Yes.
So I was at the climate symposium, so my question is kind of related to that. But would you say that Israel being one of the countries that's being affected by the climate crisis is also adding to like some of the political tension? So like, I know that you touched on the fact that there was a protest over installing like windmills and stuff like that, which is kind of in that push to get more sustainable energy and to try to fight back climate change, especially in an area that's so susceptible. So would you say that these tensions are either adding to that or that they could be possibly even causing some issues in how to navigate that?
The demonstration of the Druze was not a demonstration against renewable energy. It was a deal that was cut from a wind turbine company with private landowners and the general public there. They might have told Charlesville that they were not. So I don't think I would interpret it. Generally, these communities have very pro-environmental on the whole, and there's been specific issues when they expand their villages. But for the most part, I have always seen the Druze as great allies in the environmental issues. So unfortunately, the climate is not yet an issue as it was, for example, in Denmark and places like that, which would bring down the government. That's something for the future that we could be. And then I wanted to just clarify that I agree with what Professor Dion said, that certainly you could not blame the Islamic Party for bringing down this government. It could have been interpreted from what I said. The point I was making was the Israeli political arena is open to all its citizens. And if we could find a way to give Arab citizens a sense of engagement and being full stakeholders and get those votes, I think we'd also be a major step towards the kind of Israel.
Thank you.
So many questions. I had to pick which ones I want to ask. So I'll start with a couple of maybe easier questions. First, Ziel, it seems like, based on what we've heard from all four panelists, that the opinion polls that talk about, do you consider yourself right or left, and the shift of those, are very, very limited value, because it seems like the term right and left just are inadequate describe what's going on. That's more of, I guess, a comment that respond to. This is also kind of a very specific question. When you were talking about the intricacies of the legal questions, you talked about the Supreme Court deciding whether this or that aspect of the basic laws were unconstitutional or not. Mm-hmm. And just as a linguistic question, how in Hebrew does one even articulate these issues? Because, of course, talking about something not being constitutional, which maybe just the way you speak about in English, is kind of because there is no constitution. So how do we even talk about finding something unconstitutional when there is no constitution?
You use it.
You still use the term.
Many years ago, we sat together in constitutional law class in the university.
Right.
So.
Yeah.
So I'll just let you that question first, and then I'll just.
Oh.
Yeah.
So the discussion has proceeded as if there is actually a common law constitution type of reasoning.
Okay.
So that's essentially what the argument of Justice Barrett is that. The basic laws have created, in his view, at least some of them, constitutional documents that he can perceive as a constitution. So that has really been the premise.
I mean, I think you're partially right in that the, you know, what does it mean kind of writing the left anymore? And part of it was because the left was so delegitimized, especially after the second Intifada. What was really public was told by Bill Clinton and Bill Clinton, they had given a generous offer, Camp David, and Homer in 2008, it kind of really diffused, kind of delegitimized kind of anybody wanting to call them a leftist, kind of like in the United States, where at different times the label liberal has been denigrated by so many sectors of society that some people don't want to adopt that definition anymore. So to a certain extent, that's what happened to the realized people, even if they have some positions that for so many years accorded with the left, will no longer identify themselves as left. So that's true. On the other hand, when we see these kind of concerning statistics of a growing number of people, even in just the past year, 4 years, prioritizing saying that Jews should have more rights than non-Jews, that is a belief one would associate with kind of a right position, as well as the certain element that is luckily, I still think that the number of Israelis who support this position, just like with Palestinians, because the solution has increased, but plurality is still much at stake. But those who are against it, or those who don't believe in equal rights, certainly would fit very well in what we would call the right orientation. But there are complications, but probably there are more people who, if you look at particular questions, would actually be categorized perhaps as center or center left, but that categorization has been so delegitimized that maybe it doesn't fully capture those people who might fall.
Question of Israel, democracy, what kind of democracy, and what is at stake, both kind of in descriptive terms, but also in rhetorical terms, in this question. Because it seemed like, if I understood your argument, you were saying Israel, kind of from the get-go, is an illiberal democracy. So in some ways, your argument seemed to be saying that actually nothing really has changed. This is kind of path that it's been on, and things have gotten worse, but that in some ways this was in the cards from the get-go, if I understood it right. And you kind of started the talk by saying, well, there are these terms that we call liberal democracies, and the US, Germany, et cetera, some people might argue that these democracies have problems, but ultimately we kind of still call them liberal democracies. So there is a kind of comparative aspect to this argument rhetorically, right? That if Israel is an illiberal democracy, it's kind of implicitly compared to not just an ideal of liberal democracy, but the reality of other countries having liberal democracies. So then I think of a country like England, where you said, okay, Israel already has kind of the cards stacked against it because it doesn't have a constitution, because of its tension between the ethnic nature and the liberal reserved for members of the Anglican Church. The head of the Queen of England is the head of the Anglican Church. There are probably people in England who, if you interviewed them from different sectors of society, you could find different tribes in England that don't kind of mix and match. Or people who think, well, you know, I never thought that England was much of a democracy to begin with. But I think at the beginning of the conversation, we said, you know, what are the countries that seem to fit most easily into the idea of a liberal democracy? We might have to dispute whether England would actually go. So I guess this is what I'm saying, is it's hard for me to formulate the question, but there seems to be something really important at stake in trying to figure out, you know, what kind of democracy is Israel, and it seems to be both descriptive but also kind of comparative. And so it's really just, I'm struggling to kind of figure out what's at stake in that question, separate from there are real problems and issues and populations that rights aren't being acknowledged and expressed, and there's injustice in Israel that needs to be addressed. That seems to be kind of a question over here that there really isn't a lot of dispute about. But then there's this other question of, well, how do we describe its democracy, which has another force? And I'm not sure if you can make anything from that mess. these are the kinds of questions that I'm trying to just make sense of. And what's at stake in this question? Because we keep coming back around to it. It seems really important. But ultimately, you know, I'm not really sure about it.
It's an excellent comment that could lead to a question. We could formulate we need a symposium to formulate the question. I think
we're going to have
if you're right by raising this, what is democracy? How would you define that? How do we use these tools to be able to define and compare? So it's an abstract definition of it, and then there's the comparative aspect of it, and then even when you do comparative political study, you could use criteria of three branches of power, separation of powers, more qualitative research, and you could use indexes such as mentioned at the beginning of the level of democracy for those indexes, and then there are so many of those out there, each one of them would give you a different answer of where to situate Israel versus the UK or the US and so forth. So it's not an exact science, it's not a formula that you could put there and you get an answer. A sense of democracy in a country is situated for its own geography, for its own people, for its history, for everything that comes in, and you cannot just copy that and put it in another place. So yes, the UK does not have a constitution, but really, would you compare the UK to Israel? Israel with 75 years of history, and the UK with much more than that. Talking about history, where they do not have one legal document that is a constitution, but at least they have that president of decisions that have been made throughout the decades that establish a form of a government, a form of a bill of rights that does not exist in Israel. What do we have in Israel? We have two basic laws out of the 13 that were mentioned, only two that mention sporadically two major items that are relevant to a bill of rights, which is human dignity and liberty to some extent, that is used by the justices to expand it as much as they could, which created now the problem that there's a pushback against that. And the second one, which is the freedom of occupation, which you can mean that you can have any job that you want. That's it. Where's the freedom of expression, the freedom of gathering, the freedom from religion, and so forth, take the Bill of Rights and just compare. We don't have that. In the UK, there is much more than this, and I'm not an expert in the UK, just to now throw things that say this exists over there and that does not exist in Israel, but from what I remember the last time that they compared Israel to other countries, the UK and other countries would have much more than that. But I think this does not provide an answer to what you said, and I'm sorry about that, and I think we will need much more time to delve into much more details to talk about that and make an informative decision for ourselves of, okay, what do we want, actually? We cannot reach to that full imagined idea of a liberal democracy. No country is there, actually. Each country is in different steps and getting closer to that, or maybe pulling away from that, different ways of the problems proceed and change. And this is the question about this: where do we want to find it? Closer or
I just to say, I'm not a political scientist, so all these definitions tell me a lot to me. I'm a policy person, looking at trends, and beyond a direct vote, to me, part of democracy does it offer equality of opportunity to all citizens. And here, Israel started very low, okay? For objective reasons, over 90% of Arab women did not have a degree in 1949, okay? And if you look at where Arab women are today, where they're 40% of the students at the Technion's architecture school, or the medical profession, or the fact that there are Arab justices, not enough in any of these areas, and they win the master chef competition. In every, all these areas of life, you're seeing greater participation. I'd say we're on the right track. And that's why this judicial reform is so dangerous. Because the danger is that without the protection, and I understand it's been imperfect, the protection, but it has been, it's not nothing. And the threat of it to racist bureaucrats who might discriminate is very real, that they might go. And so therefore, I think, sort of putting my comments in, that's why it's very, very important that our Supreme Court show its integrity and its courage in making a decision to dissolve the Star Test. It stopped, but generally.
Thanks for a great discussion.
It
was very
lively.
I think we all learned lots of different angles and lots of different points of view, so I thought fantastic to have all three of you here, and thank you so much for your patience with earlier technical difficulties with the movie and for your engagement and staying, and hopefully we'll continue the conversation in different ways and classes and other things. So thank you so much for coming. And